So welcome everyone to our virtual career fair strategy session with GM. And I don't know about you, Kathy, but I can't believe it that this is our last one of these career fair prep sessions. We've had a busy calendar lately, so we're excited to get started. I've asked everyone to chat in their name and class standing and major, just so we get a sense of who's here. And if everyone can make sure that they're on mute, and also make sure your chat audience is all participants or everyone, so that if you ask any questions, everyone can see those. And feel free to chat those questions in as we go. We'll try and take those as they come. Makes for a more interesting presentation if you guys are asking those questions as they come up. We, as I mentioned, we are recording the session so that we are posting these videos on Handshake. So if you need to go back and reference it later, you can do that. Or if you need to tell a friend how awesome it was, they can watch it too. So we will go ahead and get started with introductions. Kelly on the left isn't here. So I will ask Jake, who's on the call, to introduce himself in place of Kelly.
Hi, I'm Jake Buchanan. I'm a career ambassador at Career Services. I'm a computer science junior, and that's really me.
Okay, thanks, Jake. And Kelly is a career consultant that is, as I mentioned, out today. And I am Laura Croker, also a career consultant, and really excited to share my past experiences in human resources and recruiting and interviewing a lot of people and looking at a lot of resumes with students at Oakland. And next, Kathy, can you introduce yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm Kathy Leivelsberger, and I lead the SECS Career Services team. And in addition, I get to work with great employers like General Motors to help them recruit here at Oakland. And I enjoy also being a career coach to students.
Okay, excellent. And now we get to hear from the GM team that's here.
Alrighty, well, I guess I'll start then. My name is Kyle Jones. I'm actually in Oakland University alma mater, Go Grizzlies. I graduated back in 2016. I've been at GM, it'll be 5 years in June, this June. My current role within the company, I'm an IT business analyst and bot technologist. So I work in the end user experience space around our Carly virtual assistant, which is our chat bot, and I'm utilizing artificial intelligence.
Awesome. My name is Sarah Faber. I'm a delivery lead in global data, AI and analytics services. AI is our team that's for artificial intelligence. I went to Oakland for my master's and I've been at GM for about 5 years now. And we're working on a lot of big data projects, especially the ones that I have in my roadmap for this year surround our connected vehicle ecosystem. And other predictive measures that we want to put in place for a smart vehicle and a better customer experience.
Okay, great. Now we've got a video that we are going to share. Here we go. Hopefully technology is my friend today. And maybe give me a thumbs up if you can hear. Okay.
Looked at a thousand different pictures that your mother took of you. You see, I had this crazy dream last night. This man, he talked to me. He told me everything that's good and bad about my history. And the future looks good. The future looks good. And I swear that you are the future.
You
most amazing things happening in the environmental space, the energy space, the healthcare space, the entertainment space, the technology space, are all happening in the space between the wheels of every vehicle GM is making right now.
We're all set for auto control.
Okay, so it's kind of hard to follow that presentation because that was so cool, but I'm going to try my best. I'm going to pull up my presentation. Anything else, Sarah? Oh, you want to mention before we get started on the rest? Hang on.
Sorry, I was muted. No, I think we're okay. We can get right into it.
Oh, I need to figure out how to stop that. There we go. Okay, Sarah, go ahead and I'll start sharing again.
No, that's okay. I think the video kind of really highlights all of the innovation that and the forward thinking that we see the future in a different way back then. And we're coming to this inflection point of really seeing it through to fruition with all of our major commitments with 000. And at the end of the session, I can share that link among other links because we just also presented at CES all of these really cool things. So that's a customer, consumer electronic show. And we had a virtual booth. So it's cool because then we can share with even more people about where we're at and where we're headed.
Okay, awesome. Thank you, Sarah. So we will go ahead and get started on some of the information about our career fair. So it is less than a week away now. It's happening next Wednesday from noon to 4 o'clock. It's all online and it's via Handshake. So it's very similar to the fall if you participated in the fall. And we've got a little bit more information to go over about that. So I have a question to get everyone started. What is similar about a virtual career fair versus an in-person career fair? If you can go ahead and use the chat and tell us what you think is the same about a virtual career fair versus an in-person career fair. Don't be shy. This is one of the things you'll learn later in the presentation. It's important to interact. Okay, good. Talk to different employers, group interviews, conversing with potential employers. Great. Very good. So yes, employers are definitely a big part of both virtual and in-person career fairs. So some other similarities are you still need to dress professionally. Unfortunately, Zoom attire, since we're in a Zoom world, is still not appropriate for career fairs. So you at least need to be professionally dressed on the top. You're still going to get a lot of opportunities to interact with employers. Sometimes our employers are feeling like the interactions are even better in this virtual world. You still need to be prepared with your resume, your elevator pitch, and research on the company. Okay, so we talked about what's the same. What's different about virtual career fairs and in-person career fairs? This is where I need my Jeopardy, right, Kathy? Do, 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 do. What's different? Nobody thinks anything's different. No handshakes. Yep. That one I won't miss. That one's a good one. No handshakes. That's not on my slide. It's easier one-on-one contact, Zoom meetings, introductions different. Okay, good. So some other things that are different is you can't just show up the day of the career fair, be all dressed and ready to go and talk to employers. You need to do a little bit of time thinking in advance of where you can do it. So you need to find a quiet environment. It's best to find a neutral backdrop. You need to find a good internet connection. You need to make sure your handshake profile is complete. In a real world, that's still awesome to have done, but in a virtual world, it's really important to have that handshake profile complete. And you also need to schedule appointments in advance, which is a lot different than in a regular career fair. So it takes a little bit more planning upfront. So here are some basic details. As I mentioned, it is hosted on Handshake, and depending on the session, it might be video, audio, or text-based chat. There are both group sessions and individual sessions, and employers are looking for both students for internships and full-time career opportunities. And Sarah, Kyle, Kathy, Jake, if you guys have anything to add in, feel free. Students, you have questions, feel free to pop them in the chat. And these are the same reasons to attend a virtual career fair as an in-person career fair. It's an awesome opportunity to connect with recruiters and other professionals in your field. A lot of times companies attend engineering professionals, or they have engineering professionals, IT professionals attend. So it's a really good way to start talking to them, learn more about your field of interest, start building your network. You can learn about different career opportunities and really build those relationships with employers that you might want to work with someday. So these are some basics that you have to do in order to get started. You have to register in Handshake. You have to update your Handshake profile. You have to upload your resume, and you have to work on your elevator pitch. So those are some basic things that we need to be getting started on. Yes, I will send out the recording of the session in the next day or two. It depends how quickly I get the recording. Okay, after you register, you're not done. It's not like you can register and walk away and then show up the day of the event. You need to make sure that your Handshake profile privacy setting is set to community. If it's not set to community, you're not going to be able to fully interact with the employers and other participants at the career fair. So it's really important to set that privacy to community. I can show you later, or if you have questions on that, you can feel free to email me. You need to review which employers are attending the fair, and then you need to sign up for the group and the one-on-one sessions and start building your schedule. So you need to see who's there, see who's interested in your major, see who's interested in your class standing, see who's looking for an internship, if you're looking for an internship, or a full-time, if you're looking for full-time, but really see who might be good for you to talk to, and then start building your schedule. And we have some tips on that a little bit later. Oh, right here. Okay, so scheduling tips. Make sure that you don't start with your number one dream company first. These things take a little bit of time to start building your confidence. And so maybe if GM is your dream employer, the career fair goes from 12 to 4, maybe you book GM at like 2 o'clock, 2:30. So you've had some time to get comfortable in this setting. Make sure you know which buttons to click. Each time you talk to an employer, you're going to get more and more comfortable. And so one of our tips is don't start with that dream employer, number one. Another tip, don't book back-to-back one-on-one sessions. The reason for this is the way Handshake has it set up, employers are allowed to run over for 10 minutes in a one-on-one session. And so that means that if you have a 1 o'clock session and a 1:10 session, let's say Sarah was talking to an awesome person before you. So maybe she ran over. I'm not saying you will run over, Sarah, but maybe she ran over and she didn't get to you until 1:05, then you only have 5 minutes before your next session starts. Well, you don't want to cut Sarah off because you're having an amazing conversation with her, but you also don't want to be late for your next session. So the easiest way to avoid that situation is don't book back-to-back one-on-one sessions because being on time, that's another one of our tips we'll see, is really important. Anyone have anything else on the scheduling tip?
I try to be really cognizant of this. I try to open up more than just every other personally, just so I can get to as many students. So I'll have a run of like 3 in a row. So I know the first 2 I have to be on time.
It's really
but I try to, it's a balance between do I open up more sessions and see more students, or do I just make sure I'm on time?
Yeah.
So I try and balance that out and do a little bit of both on my schedule.
For the employers, I'm sure it's very hard because 10 minutes can fly by. So definitely a challenge. So students, it's really important for you to be aware of that and build your schedule so that you can, you know, if Sarah wants to keep on talking to you, it's in your best interest to keep on talking to her. So just make sure that that doesn't impact a later appointment. Another tip that we're offering is if an employer, like GM, for example, is offering a group and individual session, it's in your best interest to do both of them. And you might say, well, that's redundant. Well, no, because in the group session, it's a half hour. you're going to learn a lot of basic overview information about GM, really great information. Then when you go to your individual session, you can use some of that information that you gained in your individual session. So you could say something like, well, I saw that video in the group session earlier today, and I just was so inspired. I think that GM is really the place for me. And maybe be more detailed about what really stood out to you about the video. But then Sarah is going to be really impressed because she knows that you took the time to go to her group session and listened and are bringing it up with her. So that's a really good thing to do. Employers are noticing those students that are attending multiple events.
Good strategy. I also have our group session first thing too. So there is that opportunity.
Perfect.
Okay. Can I just add something here?
Yeah.
For any students on the call that this might be relevant for. If for some reason you're not ready for a one-on-one with Sarah and her team, there's still a great reason for you to join one of the group sessions. You'll get some great background information and learn more about the company and the people. And as you become ready to apply to positions at GM and go into their interview process, you'll have some great background. And there are spots available in those group sessions. I'm probably going quickly, so get in there and sign up for those.
Great. Thank you, Kathy and Sarah. Okay, a couple of tech tips to make sure that you are making the most of this. Handshake operates the best on Chrome and Firefox. So I would definitely make sure you have one of those browsers. And as with everything, it's always good to have a backup plan. So there is an app that you can get on your phone or iPad or, you know, whatever, and you can download that. And so then if for some reason it's not working on your laptop, you can try it via the Handshake app. So I would definitely recommend having Chrome or Firefox and then also get the app as well. Keep in mind, you can also test your video. So if you have an individual session, you can log on the day of the career fair up to 5 minutes before the individual session starts. So if your individual session is at 1 o'clock, up until 12:55, you can test your video to see if it works. So that's another good thing that you can do just to relieve some of that stress and make sure that everything is good to go. Oh, I'll back up. Another thing I just want to mention on the tech side is sound quality. And that's really important. And I think we talk about it a little bit later. But one of the things that is always comforting is knowing you're not going to have a problem with your sound connection. And something that I have noticed is when I'm doing these presentations, when I have my student appointments, I often am using my trusty Bluetooth headset because it's more comfortable. But when I'm doing these presentations, I'm using my earbuds that are wired because I know that my Bluetooth isn't going to go out in the middle of the session. Something bad might happen with it, but this is, you know, an old standby. So that might be something to make sure, you know, that you're fully charged. Maybe you have a backup set of earbuds because that sound quality is really important. Okay, let's switch over to Handshake for a second. Let's see in our audience. I want to know if A, you have a Handshake profile, and B, is it at 100%? So let's see how our studio audience is doing. 100%, awesome. Yes and yes, good. Good news. 80%, yep. Sometimes it's hard to get to 100%. Maybe you haven't had a class project yet. So sometimes it is hard to get to 100%. Okay, so here are some reasons to make your Handshake profile. Employers are using Handshake to find candidates for positions. So whether you know it or not, they are going on and doing searches to find candidates that might meet the openings that they have. You can see in Handshake who's looked at your profile, and that's always kind of fun to see who's been checking out your profile. If your profile is more up to date, they are going to be more interested in you as a candidate, and they might message you about positions that you never even knew existed. And so having your Handshake profile up to date might bring attention to your profile by employers, and then they might be interested in your profile for specific positions. So it's definitely important to have that Handshake profile ready for the career fair, but then also just in general, it's going to help your chances of finding employment in the future. So Handshake basics. These are things that are on your Handshake profile and can't be edited, those first couple ones. You can also, down below, you can edit your education and start end dates. That just gives employers an idea of when you started your college career, when you're planning on finishing up, which is really helpful in an employer's eyes. You can also put your department GPA on there. If you really want to isolate your engineering core GPA, you can add that. And then there's also a box that you can check whether or not you display your GPA to employers. Our standard recommendation is if it's over a 3.0, you display it to employers. Sarah, anything that on this section that stands out to you about profiles and the basic stuff?
I just the fact that I think they are really helpful. I try my best to review them about a week or so before when everything's getting filled up. And if I notice something like I have a cybersecurity expert on the roster and on my schedule, I might suggest, well, do you want to talk to the cybersecurity expert? Because that's not me. Just because it fits their interest a lot better. And it's such a niche field. So it's been really helpful to make sure they get the best experience themselves for what they're interested in. Otherwise, it's just helpful for me to understand and prepare the one-on-one with some links or something specific of what they're looking for, because I do try to pull specific postings or links that might be relevant to their background. And I was just looking again, we do have, I think the only sessions open are the group session, but I had a new person sign up. So Matt Swanson does have 3 sessions available, and he's a director of the IT Shared Development Center. So he's a great person to chat with. I'm sure his 3 spots will go quick today.
Okay, students. So just so you know, my feelings won't be hurt if you open up another tab and register for that session, since Sarah just brought attention to it. So just come back to this tab when you're registered and keep on listening. Okay. So some of the things that Sarah mentioned is, you know, she's looking at students, what they're looking for. So one of the places she might find that on students' profiles is in their journey statement. These are all areas that you can upload, or you can customize your Handshake profile. So you can upload your resume, profile picture. For the profile pictures, I always recommend something professional, just looking at the camera straight on, just your face. Make sure you don't cut out your girlfriend or boyfriend or friend. You can always tell when someone has cut someone else out. This doesn't have to be anything fancy though. You can just put on something professional, stand against a neutral wall, and have a friend take it with an iPhone or a phone of some sort. And then you can upload that. Just helps again make that profile that much more complete, makes a complete picture for the recruiters. And Ashton, I love that comment about a selfie stick. That's perfect. That's perfect. Great. Good idea. Okay, so we talked about the journey statement. You also have your work and volunteer experience on there, organizations and extracurriculars. These are really important sections for employers to see. It shows what you've been working on. It shows if you're involved on campus, what your interests are. Courses, we recommend 4 to 5 courses on your resume. Those ones should be relevant to what employers are looking for based on the positions you're applying to. So, and those will probably change as you go through your career, but we do recommend keeping it 4 to 5 courses. And you can also identify skills. If you're looking at a job description and you see certain skills in the job description that you have, you can always add those skills to your profile, because if they're searching for certain skills, that might help trigger you into their search results. Course projects. That's important to have on there. Sometimes they're looking for utilization of special technologies or teamwork. And then you can put your interests on there too. So you can tell employers where you're looking for positions, if you're looking for a full-time role, internship, what industries you're interested in. And those are all things that employers can look at. And Maddie, you are welcome to ask questions whenever it works for you.
Perfect. I had one quick question about extracurriculars.
Sure.
So if I'm involved in the extracurricular, like I'm in like the group, but they haven't had any meetings, would I still want to list it on there? I mean, I know I wouldn't, because there hasn't been any experience that I have in the group.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But, go ahead.
If you've officially joined the group, my recommendation would be to include it on your resume. And then if someone asks you about it, I think it's you can be transparent that it's a group that you've recently joined, but they, due to the pandemic, they haven't had any activities yet. If you're looking for other groups to join, you can feel free to email me afterwards, because we do have a lot of groups right now that are meeting even during the pandemic. Okay. And so that might be helpful as well.
Perfect. Thank you.
Good question. Okay. Anyone else have anything on the handshake profile? And Sarah and Kyle, anything that stands out to you about handshake profiles? Anything else?
Just that they're really helpful.
Okay.
I do use them all the time.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. So more stuff to do before the event. It's always good and important to research the companies you're going to meet with before the event. And for those of you that were on the call yesterday, I talked a little bit more about this, and I suggested some places where you can do that company research. And if you want, that's in the elevator pitch workshop we did yesterday, and that's posted on Handshake. But the reason why this is important is because, again, it shows that you're really interested in that company, that you did your homework. You're motivated to be successful with their company, so you're already doing your research and your homework. That really stands out to employers. I know when I was a recruiter, I always thought it was fun when people would tell me facts that were on our company website that I didn't even know, because again, that shows me that they did their research. And pick something that you're really interested in, that you're passionate about, that really stuck out to you, because that passion and that excitement is really transparent to employers. It's also a great idea to apply to any positions of interest. You can drop that into a conversation with Sarah and say, hey, I applied to this position. If you stand out to her and make an impression, she maybe will contact the hiring manager or maybe make a note in your file. But it's really a good idea that if you're applying to positions before the event, then make note of those in your conversations with the employers. And then again, if there's any events with an employer of your choice on campus, it's in your best interest to participate those and interact so that the employers know that you're there. Again, the more you interact with them, the more they are going to note your presence and you might stand out to them. Okay, more prep work. So again, this is different than in a face-to-face career fair, but you need to make sure that your space is set up for success. That's really important. So here, my Bitmoji, I don't feel like she's set up for success. It's kind of overwhelming. I don't do well in that type of a setting. So you wanna make sure that you have minimal distractions. And part of that maybe is a clean work surface so that you're not fidgeting with things or you're really in a good state of mind to focus on the computer. And you wanna try and find a quiet, private environment. I know for some of us that's hard. So maybe it's not super quiet and private, but maybe the most quiet and private it is. I know we were on one of these calls and I think it was in the fall, and one of our employer partners was in a closet because that was the quietest place in their house. So, you know, just do some thinking about where is the best place to be. Another thing we talked about is internet connection. So make sure that you have a strong internet connection. If possible, have a neutral background. You know, sometimes that's not possible. So if there's a lot going on in your background, just make sure it's clean. So if you're in your bedroom, for example, make sure you made your bed. Or if your closet doors are open, maybe just close your closet. That'll present better to the employers. Anything you guys have seen in these virtual worlds that's either a positive or a negative?
I love the virtual backgrounds. I know Handshake doesn't have them yet, but we use a lot of Teams at work, and these Zooms really makes it for a better background when we can't have one. So
yeah,
I always loved this part of the virtual experience. And I think Handshake will eventually evolve its way there, I'm sure.
Great tip. Okay, and making sure that you are set up for success. So look at the webcam, make sure your face is square in the frame. I've had some student appointments where, and it's fine for a student appointment, but I was thinking in an interview setting, probably not the best, but they're like laying back on a couch and you can barely see them. So, you know, kind of sit up straight, look straight at the camera. Another tip I saw is you should be able to put three fingers over your head And I think that just is making sure that you're not too close to the camera. That just makes it visually more appealing. Try and speak slowly, clearly. Again, we talked about the sound connection. It's even more important in a virtual world. And again, that you know, confident body language, sitting up straight. And again, we talk about the professional clothes, no Zoom attire, at least on the top. Okay, during the event, this is what the individual sessions are going to look like. And as I mentioned, employers have a choice to set up individual sessions, group sessions, or a combination of both. So you'll see employers have a wide variety of sessions styles that they're doing. For the individual sessions, they are 10 minutes and it's one employer and one student. So this is very much like at a career fair when you walk up to a table and maybe talk to Kyle. So it's one employer, one student. It's really important to arrive on time. We talked about the timing. They're only 10 minutes. So if you're late, you are losing precious minutes with an employer. So make sure you arrive on time. You want to have a brief elevator pitch, typically around a minute. If you need help on that, as I mentioned, we do have videos on Handshake and a lot of documents that can help you craft that. And I think depending on who you're talking to, it really could be a very informal conversation or it could be a mini interview. So you really need to be prepared for both styles. And I guess my difference would be an informal conversation is, you know, hey, what are you looking for? Kind of back and forth talking about what you're looking for. A mini interview might be some of the more behavioral questions that might happen during those 10-minute sessions. At the end, it's always great to ask for contact information. Some people will share their email with you. Some will suggest that you connect on LinkedIn, but I would definitely take advantage of those connections that you're making. These are some questions that an employer may ask in that individual session. Tell me about yourself. Why are you interested in this company? What do you know about our products and services? What do you hope to do with your degree? Which classes have you liked the most and least? So those are some things that they might ask you. Then you need to be prepared to ask two or three questions. And again, if you do your homework, looking at the company website and kind of build your questions off of things that you saw on the company website, that again shows your motivation, shows your dedication, shows that you're really interested in the company. And Sarah and Kyle, I know you guys have been doing a lot of these, so stop me if you have anything to add. Okay, during the group sessions, these are 30 minutes and it can be up to 50 students. If it's over 15 students, it will be chat-based. If it's 15 students or less, it could be video. So you should really be prepared for both. So make sure that you have that professional attire on in case it turns out to be a video setting. Likely the company will give you an overview of them, maybe their products, their services, their mission, their culture, things like that. And they will probably give an opportunity for questions and answers. It's really important when you're using the chat feature. I know we all get pretty comfortable with maybe using Google Hangouts all day or texting, and we use a lot of slang or Bitmojis or emoticons. Keep it very professional. Don't use any slang. And just keep it very professional in the chat. And I think the most important thing in these group sessions is to interact, especially if you're trying to be noticed by the employers. It's good to ask questions, introduce yourself so that they know you're there. Now, if you are early in your college career and you're really just trying to start learning about companies and start getting comfortable in the setting, it's totally fine to attend and just observe. That is totally fine. But if you are actively in the internship search or the job search, it's really in your best interest to interact with the employers in these opportunities. Any questions or comments? Okay. After the event, it's really nice to capitalize on the connections that you made and stay in contact with these people, grow your network. If an email was provided, it's awesome to email them. Say thank you for your time. Maybe something that stood out to you about the conversation. That might also jog their memory about who you were. excuse me. So that's a really great idea. Maybe they didn't give you their email, but you have their name. So you could connect with them on LinkedIn. In your connection request, you can always include that thank you in that message when you send your connection request. And then if you're really inspired and you found a company that you love, apply or find out if there's any positions to apply to and apply to those. And then you can always, if you apply to a position, email your contact again saying, hey, I found this position, I applied to it. I'm really interested, maybe attach your resume and keep that connection going. And now I'm going to turn it over to Sarah, and she's going to tell you a little bit about their hire review process.
So like other employers, we start with everybody who applies at careers.gm.com will get a hire review. And this is a question and answer scenario where you're going to be prompted 5 different questions. And you'll have, the nice thing is it does provide you an opportunity for practice questions. And then, so you can like get used to the mode that you're going to be in about clicking through and recording yourself for those questions. It does only have the camera for about 2 to 5 minutes, so it can't go over that either. So you want to be clear and concise in your answers. But I do like the fact that it does provide the practice. And then even when you're actually not in practice mode anymore and you're doing the interview, you do have each question, it provides you 3 retries. And I actually went through it myself and I'm kind of glad I did recently so I could learn what you guys are experiencing. And I never made it on the first try of the actual real question. So do not feel bad. I got about the 2nd or 3rd on every single of the 5 questions. So that'll help. And I'm sharing just so that it's not that nobody feels anxious once they click I'm past the practice phase. Also, there's a lot of resources for practicing even before you get to the hire review practice section. I know Career Services has a lot of opportunities to help people prepare for the hire review. And if there's, even on our website, we have a whole hire view section. If you go to careers.gm.com and then click on students, there's a whole section on that page that has a hire view video about what it's about and everything like that. And then when you're answering the question, so I wanted to give a little bit of relief that there is practice and you can, and 3 retries. It is what we see in the data. I'm a data person, but we see that this is where most students get weeded out. So it's important to understand that you need to answer the questions in like what we call a STAR method. It's situation, task, action, and result. Most people are missing adding the result to their answers, and it's not voting well on their results of their hire review. And we want to make sure everybody from Oakland gets past this phase so that we can get into a proper one-on-one interview with the hiring manager. So I just wanted to make sure to point you to all these practices and resources and opportunities to learn how to best answer these questions. You can make a cheat sheet just to make sure you hit every point at that STAR method of answering questions. And then for the technical jobs, because I have to boost my technical people a little bit, but in the package of hire view that you might receive, it also may come with code view. I like code view a little better than hire view, but it comes in one package. So it doesn't matter if it's a technical job, if you make it past the hire view at that point in time, because they're both packaged together when you receive it. So you'll get a hire view, you'll do your 5 questions, then you'll also do code view. And that's where you can pick a programming language and do a little coding challenge in that language you choose. So those will be packaged together for the technical jobs. But all of these tips here are really, really important. And I wanted to add more emphasis on hire view in our process now. All these virtual, interviewing steps that we have do make for a good experience overall, I like to say, because It used to take months for people to hear back. And I get sometimes lost some really great students because they wanted to make a decision before they heard back from General Motors because they were taking too long. But with our new like virtual platform for this hire view and the interview process, it does speed things up considerably. So the early career talent team can get answers back to people within about 4 weeks time, which is a huge improvement. There are many, even though it's kind of, it takes a minute to get used to, that's why practice makes perfect. It does have the silver lining at the end of the day because you'll be able to hear back really soon. Any questions?
Okay. Yes, students, okay, great questions. Are these HireVue and CodeVue questionnaires timed?
Yes. So I can't remember the CodeVue timing. CodeVue might not be timed, but HireVue, the questions are. So you get about, I want to say it was 2 minutes per question.
Yeah, I think it's 2 and a half.
To answer. So I get 3 tries though. So 2.5 minutes, 3 times. Technically, I get a little bit more than that, but in total, you need to be clear and concise through that STAR method of answering the question. If you are going past 2.5 minutes for one of those questions, then you're not answering it in the best of your abilities. So that's practicing, writing them down. There is a situation, normal situational questions that you'll hear, but the practice section of HireVue is pretty spot on. So I would highly, I was in the practice session for a little while. I was like, oh, I'm going to get used to this because that's not timed. I mean, the questions are still 2.5 minutes, but you can keep going through the 3 questions, 4 questions they have teed up over and over again on a loop if you want to. So that really helps. But yeah, STAR is something they are looking for and making sure that you have the result at the end.
Sarah, you know what might be beneficial is if so maybe a student meets you at the career fair and then they apply on your website for a position. Do you want to walk them through what that process looks like? That might, the students might find that helpful.
Wait, can you repeat that again? Sorry, I was answering some chat questions.
I understand. So if a student meets you at the career fair and then they apply to one of your positions, do you want to tell them what the process looks like and where HireVue falls in that process and then what happens after HireVue?
Yes. Let me see. Actually, I might have a presentation that shows each individual step. I'm going to pull it up really quick.
Do you want me to stop sharing?
Sure. This is the bonuses of... being virtual, I can share. Okay. Let me see, share screen. Host disabled participant screen sharing. Oh, I'm a participant.
I did. Okay, let me enable. That didn't do it, did it?
Let me try again. Oh, I can share screen now. Okay.
Okay, perfect.
Screen to share. Okay, so this is from our presentation that we had back in fall 2020 with those leaders you see on the screen. But down here is a really good step-by-step. So first we're gonna connect and we're gonna connect in a series of ways. We're gonna do a handshake, virtual career fair. Our early career talent is always scanning the web or handshake for candidates to recruit as well. But basically the net, you connect with somebody and hopefully we can help you really apply to careers.gm.com, that career site. Sometimes you don't necessarily have to connect with a recruiter though. We get an awful lot of applications just on the career site. That's the front door. A recruiter doesn't necessarily have a magic button. You have to apply and show an interest on the website. So then once you have applied, that's when you'll get this pre-screening with the assessment. So this is the HireVue stage here. And then if you pass the assessment, there's probably the pre-qualifying questions. That's just like a questionnaire. and then the behavioral assessment. And then you'll get the higher view, which is the on-demand virtual interview and possibly code view. And then your last stop after you passing the higher view or the on-demand code view is a 2 1-hour Skype video interview with a hiring manager. And so I used to participate in these interviews. The reason they say they're 2 1-hour Skype video sessions is because they are back to back, and they want you to interview with two different people and get two different opinions. And then after that, moving through this phase, you'll get an offer, because everybody's going to get offers. No, I'm positive. The Oakland students, just they're always noted as one of our highest talent recruiting pools. So that's why I have full confidence in everybody on the call. And so then you'll get an interview and you'll get a date set in the future. And that date's usually based on your graduation date. I know they want students to be graduated before they have their start date. And the start dates range all different kinds of months. We had 2 new college hires start this month in my team alone, and we have another one starting next month. Last year, we had several that started in June, since that's a high graduation month. So any questions on this process in particular?
We did have one question in if the process is similar for both internship and job process.
Yes.
Or are there large differences?
Nope, it should be the same process. You'll still get the higher view interview and everything should be the same.
Okay.
So hi, how are you?
Hi.
Just a quick question. So if the job or internship relates to electrical engineering, would mm-hmm. you guys still, I know coding is involved in electrical engineering, would that still kind of involve coding?
I don't think so. I don't think electrical engineering gets a code view. The positions that are the early career talent information technology gets code view. And mm-hmm. then in the engineering space, I think that the job I know of that gets a code view is called software developer.
Software, right.
Yep. I don't think the specifically titled engineer positions get one. I can look into that though as well. Okay. But
so is there any type of test for electrical engineering during like an interview? Not like a test, but you know what I'm saying.
Well, in this first pre-screening area, these are just the prerequisite pre-qualifying questions about if you require sponsorship and those types of high-level questions. And then also it's an AON assessment, which is behavioral questions. Those are like, that's like a personality questionnaire,
right?
More than a test.
It's more like likely or less likely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. And then so that's for everybody. Mm-hmm. And then higher view is for everybody. Code view is where it kind of differs.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Great question. Sarah,
I'm wondering if you could help with another question. Uh-huh. I know that you shared that a lot of times people don't get through the higher view is because of their ability to answer the STAR questions.
Yep.
But I've had some students ask me, how do you get from the application to the higher view? Is there things that you're finding are trends that people are doing or not doing that cause them not to get to the next step? For example, do you want a really targeted resume or, you know, with a lot of keywords and terms in it? Or are you looking for, you know, more of something that's a little broader? What is more likely to get you into that next step beyond applying?
For the new college hires, I would probably say it kind of depends between the engineering business and the information technology sector on that answer. So first, I think engineering does end up looking for more of the targeted resume and keywords. I think they want somebody to be very highly focused in their area of expertise, whether that be in electrical engineering, mechanical, any of those types of control software, those engineering domains. In IT, I think we're a little bit more open to a generic resume. We do look for the keywords as it relates to skills and technologies. But we have one posting for IT, and IT alone is a whole organization within GM. We have like over 10,000 people just in IT alone, which is larger than some businesses out there. So we really are like a company within a company. And we have one posting. So that posting could handle a little bit more generalities so that we can see that you can be applicable in all different sectors of IT, possibly. Of course, there's always the nuance, like cybersecurity. You're definitely going to want to have a focus keyword resume on cybersecurity. But if you're not in one of those niches, then I would say a general resume focusing on your experience, skills, and technologies would be suitable so that you can try and hit all possible openings in the IT space. And then the graduation date helps because the new college hire positions are looking for people that are graduating in the near future because we want them, they have to be graduated to have the position. And we want to fill people's, fill those full-time jobs in the near term within that following year. So like for fall of this past year and this winter, we're trying to fill positions for this calendar year, full-time jobs. We need people in the door, butts in seats. We have a lot of openings. I can speak at least to the IT space. So that might have something to do with it, because if you're going to be graduating in 2 years or in the next year, then maybe an internship is probably more appropriate, or otherwise you might be put into a, you know, like a funnel category instead of making it onto the higher review possibly, if it's just not that range of graduation date that fits those immediate openings.
Thank you for clarifying that. That helps.
Yeah.
Got some other good questions that have come in. If someone applied like a year ago, are they given the opportunity to update their video and coding that was already submitted?
Yes, I actually asked that question recently because I had somebody in my funnel and I was like, well, can they apply again? And so they said if it's after a year's time frame, then it's considered a brand new application and you go through the process all over again versus riding on your previous answers. It's that calendar year that would have to elapse before everything is net new.
Okay. Does GM see that your previous results, or is that wiped clear?
They might be able to still look them up if somebody asked, but I was told it's you'd get brand new HireVue interview questions, brand new results.
Yep. Does GM use any resume reviewing software to select candidates?
Oh gosh, I don't know the HR black box answer on that one. I'd have to look into their crystal ball. I can only assume so, but I have no idea. Sorry.
Okay, how about this one? When I was searching the career website earlier, I saw some positions that had BEYA 2021 STEM at the end of the title, and some did not for the same job title. And I was wondering what the difference was to those compared to the ones that didn't have them at the end.
B-Y-E.
B-E-Y-A.
Let me write this down. Where's my pen? B-E-Y-A.
And if you follow up with us, I can follow up with a student too.
Yeah, let me follow up with you. Maybe it's specific to a certain, because we have, I don't know if you've seen in the news, but we have a whole diversity organization now. So there might be some kind of diversity inclusion positions that are posted specifically. And that one makes me think of that for some reason.
You're right.
Maybe it's like Black Engineers of something, something organization of STEM.
Of the year award. Someone typed it. It was Black Engineer of the Year.
There we go. Not too bad. So So that goes back to the organization we have very specifically about inclusion and diversity. Mary stood that whole, like actually appointed a vice president and stood up a whole organization after all of the issues around race that came up in the past year. She really wanted to meet that head on, and that GM is an inclusive environment.
Very cool. We are almost done. The questions are great, but I wanted to show students really fast where the career fair was and what they would need to look for on the day of the event. So if you haven't registered yet, it is under events.
I don't know if you want to share. Oh, there we go. I see your screen now.
And if you can see, I already registered for it, but if you hadn't registered, it would be under career fair and it's right there. And then if you pull up the virtual winter career fair, this is what it looks like. If you go over here and put in GM, for example, my settings, it looks like GM is not showing up in mine because this is a dummy account. So GM is in there, I assure you. And then if you select a session, for example, this city year, one-on-one with City Year. If you select that one, it will go to your sessions over here, and then it will go on to your schedule. And then on the day of the career fair, this is where you will go to join your sessions. So it will be over here. So I wanted to share that. Any questions on what to look for on the day of the career fair?
I have a question for Sarah.
Okay, go for it.
What program do you guys prefer to see in the resume when you review it? Like, for example, PSPICE, MATLAB, or Arduino, Vivaldo?
So is this a, is your area of expertise in engineering or in IT?
I'm in engineering, electrical engineering.
Okay, engineer uses MATLAB. They are trying to make a conscious effort to do a little bit more open source, just because those are the tools and platforms that our IT teams have released to them that's automatically connected to data, so then they don't have to download things and load them back up to MATLAB. So those open source tools are going to be more geared towards Python, and we have installed the Octave library so that some of the very general MATLAB code can technically be copy pasted into Octave, but any of the special add-ins, it's not applicable, of course, but we do try to put out there all the open source tools and technologies, and then they have Jupyter notebooks and all those other things to play with in that case. So I know they actively use MATLAB still, but are making conscious effort for anybody who needs the base license to just drive them to Octave instead. And then if you need if you have a justification for the special add-ins, then you get the MATLAB. So it's a good experience to have. They look for it just in case you need that, the special add-ins, but to be on the up and up, I would always recommend the open source training if you have opportunity to do that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Good question. Okay, I'm just going to wrap up a couple of things. Here is your homework list. Make sure you register for the career fair, sign up for sessions, complete your Handshake profile, research your companies that you're interested in, prepare your elevator pitch, decide what to wear, and decide where you'll conduct it. And we are here to help. We might have a couple of appointments left in Handshake. Big interview, wanted to mention on that really fast. I'll include this in my follow-up email, but if you are looking to prepare for a HireVue interview, this is a really great way because it's basically the computer asking you a question and you can practice with your answers. We have a lot of resources available on Handshake to help you get ready. We have our LinkedIn user group you can join to, we'll share a lot of content there and on Instagram. And the day of the fair, we'll have support in a prep room. And then I did want to mention, we do have companies that are still registering. So DTE Energy and AJM Packaging just registered this morning. So those sessions will be going live soon. We mentioned GM sessions are filling up fast, so you'll want to register for them. And there are also a lot of smaller companies that have a lot of really interesting positions. One of them I saw that was registered was Automatic Pet Feeder or something like that. I thought that sounded really interesting. So check out those smaller companies too. Next week, we have a couple of last minute events coming up with a virtual quick chat on February 1st for any last minute questions. Then on February 2nd, we have another event to answer any last minute questions. And then on the 3rd, if you're having any technical difficulties, want to run through that elevator pitch, we'll be available in the prep room. Okay, so I will include the LinkedIn group link and the Instagram account in the follow-up email as well. That'll probably be easiest for me. So I'll do that in the follow-up email. No problem. I think, let's see, it's 1:02. I went a little over. I'm not sure if Sarah and Kyle need to jump off or if they have time for any other questions.
One super quick question for Laura. If you can answer. So basically, I'm looking to modify my journey statement on Handshake. There's things on Handshake that'll tell me what to change, correct? If I can just search around.
Yeah, there's resources, but I can follow up with an email to you.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
No problem. And Sarah chatted in a bunch of links as well.
Yeah, those are hot links right there. The 000 ad was the one we watched at the beginning of this presentation. We have some really cool engineering because GM's doing a lot of their own events, especially heavily in the fall. Last fall, they had autonomous and cybersecurity had leaders and everybody talking about their domains, and they were recorded on Vimeo. So those are available. If you're an engineer or in cyber, please check those out, or if you're just interested. And then the 2021 CES Exhibit Zero is available virtually, so we can share that with everybody. And there's awesome high-level leaders talking about everything under the sun. Mary's on there. I really liked the CES exhibit. It was really well done, and there's everything's recorded. And then the careers website, that's the gateway. That is the key. If you don't apply, that's it. Like, you just got to apply. I even have it up here.
Okay.
Thank you guys so much.
Anything else? Well, thanks everyone for attending. And I will email out all the information that I said. And if I didn't get anything, if I forget something and you want to email me back, and I'll get it to you. And I'll include Sarah's links as well.
Thank you so much.
Thank you to the General Motors team. We really appreciate your time and meeting with us and our students.
Not a problem. Looking forward to the career fair next week.
Yes. Kyle and I will both be there. So we look forward to seeing you guys.
And if you're lucky, maybe you'll get a time slot with them.
I have a lot of group session spots, guys. Come on.
Hey, Sarah. I'm actually in one of the group sessions, but awesome. I was hoping to get into one of the one-on-one sessions. I'm a bioengineering student.